Hello everybody, hope you're doing marvellously well. This is a very exciting song for me. When I worked on this song many years ago now, I didn't know what it would become. It ended up becoming an absolutely massive hit. I believe at one stage it was the most downloaded song of all time, and it also got used in more teen dramas and TV shows and movies than you could ever imagine. It's the phrase, "How to Save a Life." So one of the things I loved about this song is honestly how simple it was. If you take away the drum mics, you're left with just this. A shaker part, a tambourine part, a bass DI and a bass amp, stereo piano and mono piano, a piano swell, then one, two electric guitar parts, stereo rake part, an outro guitar part, another guitar part, Celeste, a cello, a lead vocal, three backgrounds. So including tracks that were muted and stereo tracks, there's 24 tracks here of instruments. So no matter how you recorded the drums, I mean, you're up to mid-30s maybe. For those of you that will remember, this song at one stage was the most downloaded song of all time. Obviously, it's been surpassed many times in the last 14 years since it came out. It's very simplistic compared with a lot of the productions that I'm handed now to mix. So let's go through and have a quick listen to the song. This is the stereo mix of the song. Faders up, almost no plugins whatsoever.
Step one, you say we need to talk. He walks, you say sit down, it's just a talk. He smiles politely back at you. You stare politely right on through. Some sort of window to your right. As he goes left and you stay right.
What I love about this, and it's quite making me quite teary-eyed, is this is the session I track drums on. So that's the mix that we were tracking to. There's been no mixing done here. There's no additional plugins. So from the top down, the track says tambourine here, but it's actually a shaker. It's not gridded, swings a little bit. It is copied and pasted. It was a shaker part that was there before the drums. Tambourine is single hits. It's got a head on it. I personally like tambourines that have heads on them. Even though you can hear that sound. You hear it there in particular. There. So here's the bass DI. It probably wasn't anything glamorous. It was probably just a Countryman. And then the bass amp, I believe, was a B15 that the studio had. There it is. Not a lot of compression on it. You can hear the initial hit coming through. Sounds pretty natural. So this piano is the Baldwin Concert Grand Piano. And the thing about this piano was, is it ended up getting retracked in New York. But this is the session that I tracked the drums to. So this was being done the same day. So while I was tracking drums, Aaron Johnson was in New York tracking another piano. Both of those parts, the piano part and the drum part, were then given to Mark Endert, who mixed at Scream Studios. Screen Studios was quite famous not only for Mark Endert from Mixing Out Of, but of course the great Andy Wallace. Andy Wallace mixed Nevermind by Nirvana at Screen Studios as well. Mark Endert moved to Florida later on, and he took the screen console and a ton of other gear there and established his own studio there. Now, if you see in the interview I did with him a couple of years ago, he's actually mixing entirely in the box. But for the longest time, he was mixing on an SSL 9K, I believe, which is what this song was mixed on. So you'll notice if you listen to this piano, it's a lot softer than the one that eventually ended up being on the record, the one that was being recorded the same day that I did the drums. I mean, it's beautiful, it's the same part, it's just too subdued. And there's something special about that other piano. So the piano that Aaron Johnson recorded was a Yamaha C7. At Sony Studios. Unfortunately, the great Sony Studios in New York is no longer with us. So if you go back and compare the sound of the song in the album, you'll hear that it's a different piano to this one. There's some fun stuff. There's a piano swell going into the first chorus. So it's decay here. So it's just that same hit, reversed, simple as that. Joe King's guitar parts, there's quite a few. What I like about it is it's not perfectly in tune. There's a modulation delay on it. Looks like we put an auto tune on it and didn't even end up using it. It adds width to the track if there's a little tiny bit of dissonance. I have no problem with that. And then there is, of course, that, what I believe is like a really signature re-intro guitar part. And that just has a delay here. Just about half a second, a mono delay, so right on top of the guitar. There's a cutoff here of 3.5K, and it's just a good old quarter note. It's a very simple, hooky guitar part. There we go. So the other guitar parts are so simple on here, but beautiful. So what it is there's a baritone guitar playing the line here. And then it's doubled with a Telecaster. There's delay pedals on it. So you can hear that delay, but it's printed. Personally, I will always get behind printing the effects with the guitar sound. If a guitar player has a great idea and they are playing it with the pedals, they will interact with that guitar sound. So it's nice to just let them do that. Dave, the other guitar player, I suppose the lead guitarist's Vox, AC30. Really nice voicings. And then the only sound here that's programmed, it's just a sample of a mellotron cello. You hear that tape sound there? That, yeah, as the tape comes in. But it's just a sample. Everything else is real. Here's the lead vocal. There's a little bit of low mid cut here, set to 269 out of Isaac's voice, and that is it. And that's what we were monitoring the whole time, doing overdubs when we redid the drums and everything. Like I said, this mix, this rough mix you hear here, is what we are using to track drums to.
Step one, you say we need to talk. He walks, you say sit down, it's just a talk. He smiles politely back at you. You stare politely right on through. Some sort of window to your right as he goes left and you stay right.
That vocal there, no auto-tune. It's comped sometimes whole lines of verses, sometimes a word or two here. But it's not tuned, it's not timed, it's a performance. It's a comp between six takes, which is not excessive at all. There's no real reason to tune Isaac's voice because all of those inflections are what gives him character. You can easily go back and listen to the final mix that the great Mark Endo did. It's such a great mix. And you'll notice that there is no major tuning on it. Okay, here's the background.
Where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere alone. Bitterness.
There is not even vocal line on this. This is just a performance. You can have a listen to the two parts together now.
Where did I go wrong? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness. And I would have stayed up with you all night had I known how.
I like it. It goes in and out of unison here and there, but it just sounds great in the track.
Where did I go wrong?
Now you'll notice it's super drum heavy because this is, the last time I opened this up was when I was tracking drums on it many years ago. Let's listen to the backgrounds. Can't remember if we ended up using these.
Where did I go? I lost a friend somewhere along in the bitterness and I would have stayed up.
So I don't believe, off the top of my head, we ended up using those backgrounds. It was great though, because after I finished tracking these drums, we got in a car and drove over to Scream, took the hard drive and gave it to Mark. He brought out these drum takes, put them in and started mixing. I don't think there's any drum samples on it. You can pretty much tell, because he had it mixed about 3 hours later, you know, fully with the new piano in, because he'd already mixed the song for the album. And like I say, if you're one of the first 70,000 people who bought the record, there's a different version of the song in there. Everything's essentially the same as far as vocals and guitars, but different drum part and different piano part. Piano part was exactly the same part, but a different performance on the C7 at Sony. Let's get stuck into the drums. This is my favorite part. Just so you know, down below here, we did some cymbal overdubs because the groove that Ben was playing was fantastic. But we didn't want it to sort of stop to do that kind of, you know, part and then hit cymbals. We wanted it to feel consistent and moving the whole time, which, you know, just felt like the right thing to do and to keep the song, you know, keep it moving. So this is the drum sound completely untreated as I recorded it, exactly as I recorded it. Here we go. Now, the first thing you might notice is there's no toms. The kick was a Rogers, a 24-inch Rogers kick drum, black one, not that that matters, and it was only about this deep. The snare was my Ludwig Supraphonic, which I believe is like a 73. It's super pitted. I had Pro Drum, the very great Pro Drum on Vine Street, put brand new hoops on it, but the shell itself was this, that's over there. So here it is. As you can see here, pretty badly pitted. I bought it from eBay maybe a year before I did the record, and it was all browned, and I don't know, I think it was about $100, maybe a little less. I mean, they've got, even the bad ones now are worth a lot more, but we're talking like 2004 when I bought this. I've got it tuned really quite low at the moment and super damped, but I had a fresh head on it. I had a brand new Ambassador like this. It was a Remo Ambassador on it. But yeah, it's a pretty, you know, generic, good sounding snare. It's been on Aerosmith albums, a couple of Fray albums, August Arna, James Blunt when we cut James's drums. And then ever since then, pretty much every single album I've ever made. The thing I'll say about the Supraphonic, I believe it to be the most versatile snare I've ever used. The second Fray album in particular took us quite a long time because it was a massive, massive pressure for the band to make sure they could deliver again with another big album. The first album had sold 4 million copies, and it was now 2-3 years later, I believe, actually, when we started it. So there was an enormous amount of pressure. Most bands, and I can name 100, you know, their second album is a flop, and they aren't able to replicate even half the success they had on the first. So there was a lot of pressure on the band. So we did spend a long time making it, and they ended up writing a lot of stuff in the studio, and we tracked a lot of songs to get the songs that would eventually become the second album, which was called just The Fray. And again, that was a very successful album. It was a number one album in America and did really well all over the world. So that snare was on every single song of that second album except for one. And that song, I believe, was called like We Bend and Then We Break, and we used a piccolo tuned fairly high. But every other song on that second album was just that snare tuned differently. All we would do is tune it higher or lower. And the thing about the Supraphonic that I love is you can do that. You can make it a big boof snare, or you can make it clang. You could do everything. Here we've got the natural ring. We didn't dampen it down. On a lot of the songs on the second album, we dampened it down considerably, and a couple we let it ring. It's a really, really versatile snare, the Ludwig Supraphonic. And that particular one was from 1973. As I said earlier, probably cost me about, I can't remember, it was $90 or $100. They do go for more now, but considering they're not handmade and they're not really expensive boutique snares, I would argue it's the most versatile snare drum in the world and easily the best value for money snare drum in the world. So no toms, great snare. Let's go through every single mic. Here, if you see my notes, it says 12 is old way, 13 is new way. So what we did on take 12 is try a groove, and then we changed the groove idea ever so slightly. I don't think it was massive. Let's have a quick listen. But that last take was the one we chose. Yeah. So we only did one take with a new groove, and that became it. The one take with a new groove. Here's the old groove. And here is the new groove. So what it was is it was just a very, very simplistic idea. Just give a little bit more space in the verse. Not a huge amount, but everything else is the same. Talking of that, let's go through. Now the kick in was a AKG D112. So I was using a TAC, that is the inexpensive AMEC consoles, a TAC Scorpion. It was a 24-channel TAC Scorpion. But we had certain parts of the drum kit going through individual mic pre's. Kick in was a BAE 1272. I had three channels of stereo 1272s. I don't know if you can still buy them, but they're really great sounding. So that is a AKG D112. Going to a BAE 1272, going to a Yuri 546 EQ. And what I would do on that 546 is it's like fully parametric stereo EQ. I'd only use one side, and that would be on the kick in. I would just high pass to about 20. So it was a little bit more focused. I would do a bit of a 60 boost and a bit of a 350 cut. And a tiny bit of 2.5, just a tiny bit of boost. So that attack, the extra attack, is a combination of being placed inside the kick drum with a little bit of 2.5. That went into a DBX 160X, not a VU, just a 160X. The kick out is a Sennheiser 602. Now, that is all natural. It went into another 1272, channel 2 of the stereo 1272. But I didn't put any EQ or compression on it. And the mic itself is actually about this far away from the drum. It's a Sennheiser 602 pulled back, but I would baffle off. So what I would do is I would make a tunnel out of packing blankets around. So you hear a little bit of bleed, but it's just pulled back from the outside of the kick. And it's more of an overview of the sound. It's actually really good kick drum sound. I love the Sennheiser 602. No compression, no EQ. That's just the sound of the Rogers 24-inch kick with the Sennheiser 602 going through a 1272. I wouldn't be surprised if Mark Endert didn't focus on that kick, because I feel like you could take that kick and add a bit of 60 to it and get a pretty darn good kick sound. Go down to about 60 and boost. So you hear that? That's the thickness. Sounds pretty close to the record. One of the things I've always loved about listening to this single, whenever it comes on the radio or comes on Spotify, is the fact that I can hear my room mics. And especially when you go to the end of the song and nobody else is playing, you hear all of that. You hear the ring on the snare, you hear the room. Mark did an amazing job of, you know, under a lot of pressure with no time to mix that song, because it had a deadline that was just ridiculous. Go and listen to it on Spotify. You'll hear all of that. Ring, rooms, everything. He is a really amazing mixer who doesn't just have one way of doing it. It doesn't have a sound. He's an incredible mixer. Let's solo out the snare, since we talked about the Supraphonic. Here's the snare top. You hear the ring. I love it. Here's the snare bottom. Both of those are 57 top, 57 bottom. The snare top, if we go back to that for a second, is going through a BAE 1064. Those EQ points are really, really nice. So on the Neve 1064, a tiny bit of 220, probably, because I would do this often, taste of 7K, just a little boost, maybe one click on the Neve. I think I can hear that little snappiness. But also remember, that's a brand new Remo Ambassador head, which I think also helped a lot. A brand new head keeps that snappiness. And the last thing, of course, is that went into an 1176. It's the only other compression on the whole recording. So we have a DBX 160X on the kick in, and on the snare top, maybe a touch of 1 to 2 dB of 1176 compression. And my compressor was a reissue 1176 that I'd bought from Guitar Center, maybe 3 years before. Wasn't a special version, revision or anything. It was just a generic 1176. On the hi-hat, it went through the TAC Scorpion. So I had an Audio-Technica 4041, which is a fantastic pencil condenser. And I think when I bought it, it was about $200-$300 maximum. Taped together with a 57. So they're taped together, so the capsules are like absolutely in phase together. I got this from working with the great Dave Jordan, maybe 5 years before that. So Dave would do this same trick. So no EQ, but a 4041 coming on the console with a 57, and then you blend it to taste. I usually ended up favoring, and still do, a bit of the 57, but the 4041 also has a nice sonic texture. So they blend together really, really nicely. Quite a lot of bleed coming from the other stuff, but it didn't really affect the drum sound overall. The ride was a 57. I didn't have anything glamorous, so that's a 57. I don't even believe there is a ride part in the song. Let's have a listen. So I'm not even sure that Mark would have used it for the final mix. I had the ride mic up if he chose to go and play the ride, but I don't believe there's any ride in the song. Mark may have blended it for something he wanted to hear as a little extra ambience, so maybe that and the hi-hat together created something. Let's have a listen. Maybe, but ultimately, there was no ride being played. So the room mics, left and right, let's have a listen to those. I love the way these room mics sound. You'll notice the hi-hat's super quiet in them. So I had a pair of inexpensive Audix large diaphragm condensers. I believe they were like the CX-101. I saw one used recently for like less than $150. So I had a pair of those facing the wall behind the drums. So what was interesting about this is I actually measured off an equilateral triangle. So if you imagine you've got the snare drum here and then a wall behind, I measured it out so that I could have the mics equally a distance apart from each other as to the snare. So I positioned the drum kit so I could have a reflected sound that was exactly an equilateral triangle. So the phase is pretty darn good on that. If we zoom in where the snare hits would be, not bad. Might be ever so slightly late on the right-hand side. On a perfect scenario, you would take this top one of the two, measure the amount of samples out that it is. It's 35 samples out. So what I'll do is I take the room left, and this is all done, I always do this from audience perspective. I'm not a great drummer, so I don't think like a drummer. So now those will be perfectly near as darn it in phase. Well, what's great about it is you can grab the kick and the snare and you can push them up, you can brighten it, and there's no cymbals or hi-hat bleeding into it, so it becomes all about the kick and the snare. The wall behind was carpeted up to about this height. So this is at the same height as the snare, facing the wall in an equilateral triangle to the whole of the drum kit, based off the snare. Now, the wides weren't scientific at all. The wides were literally a 57 on one wall, and a 57 on the other wall. And that was it. Love it. God, I miss the sound of that room. I miss that room. That sounds so good. The mono room's pretty special. It's an Altec salt shaker mic. And it was Dave Jordan's, and he had lent it to me, going through a Joe Meek VC1. Which I absolutely loved. Because you can shape the tone of it, you can get the compression, the gain, and everything. I hit it pretty hard, and because the Altec Salt Shaker already was completely mid-rangey, I've just exaggerated that with the Joe Meek. Have a listen. But the secret to this was I took a cymbal, an old hi-hat cymbal, put it on the floor between the kick and the snare, moved stands around, finagled it, and the mic, to add that extra harshness, the Altec mic, which is already pretty mid-rangey, is actually miking the reflected sound of the cymbal. I'm gonna crank this for you all to hear. Absolutely love that. I mean, you could take these wide rooms, narrow rooms, and that, and this is a drum sound. Absolutely love that mic. Last but no means least is a mic we called the Big Room. So this was an interesting one, because between the two large rooms I had in my old studio was like a storage area, like a closet, and then another huge room on the other side. And the other huge room used to have touring bands come through and play. We had Iggy and the Stooges in there, we had the Red Hot Chili Peppers in there, we had tons of different bands come in and play in there and rehearse all day. Ziggy Marley was in there for a while. God, talk about low end. So what I would do is I would take a TLM 103 going through the console, with no compression. I didn't have any spare compression then. And all I have was the TAC Scorpion console. I put it through that and I just got a lot of gain on it and I closed the door. So all you could hear was. But unfortunately, You could also get bleed from the room next door. So there's a lot of hum. Have a listen to this. So you can hear that hum. So for EQ, before the mix, Mark would have gone in and removed that. It's acceptable around about there. Great sets of room mics that I really enjoyed that could complement each other. And that's why when I go back and I listen to this song, I love it because I can hear all of the room mics working. Perfect. So the only other thing to talk about is the fact that there's no overheads being used on that drum kit. There's no need for them. All of the cymbals were overdubbed here. I had the ride with the 57 on it, and I had the crash with the 414, just the AKG 414. Those were the only cymbals that were being mic'd, but I kept the room mics, all of the room mics, so that we could blend it to fit in. As you can see, the big room's turned off because of the low, and we didn't need it. But that's the sound. Put those two things together, and you get this. But as you can tell, what we wanted was that, just that constant kind of hi-hat, played lightly, just pushing it along, but mainly making about the kick and the snare, and then overdubbed the cymbals. Simple trick, lots of people do it, and it worked really, really well. This song was really important for me. I'd worked on a lot of other records at that point. I'd worked with Dave Sardy on 2 or 3 records. We'd done Hot Hot Heat, a lot of demos for Jet. I'd worked with The Thrills on their second album, Let's Bottle Bohemia. So I'd done lots of other, engineered other records and worked on other things, let alone tons of other things. But this was a big deal for me because this was a band I remember specifically that nobody thought was going to do anything, and they just did what they wanted to do. Song came out, and the rest is history. This song is one of the most played songs ever. It has been in more TV shows than I think any other song I can think of. I hope you enjoyed that. Please leave a bunch of comments and questions below. Thank you ever so much for watching. Have a marvelous time recording and mixing.